Hey, I'm Mike, and today I have with me
Vincent.
Vincent.
Right. Yeah, Mike. It's me, Mike, Ginger Dan, and Vincent here today. And we're talking about Kurt Busiek and Stuart Immonen's Superman Secret Identity, which is one of the books we all happened... Well, you didn't buy it. Vince didn't buy it, but me and Ginger Dan did. On the Harrisburg trip.
Go see our haul video for that, which
when
will be up
soon.
Done
and edited when I get the footage from the people who took it. Because I don't have it yet.
So, Secret Identity.
Oh.
It's a book.
It's a 4-issue prestige miniseries.
Pretty good one.
It was published in 2004. It was not technically released under the Elseworlds banner, even though you could call this an Elseworlds.
Well, DC had moved away from doing Elseworlds at that point, right?
Yeah, they pretty much... This is a 2004, and DC pretty much stopped using Elseworlds in 2003. And then they brought it back shortly in, like, 2009 or something, and they were like, we're going to do a bunch, and then it was literally only
one
series.
Yeah, they brought it back for, I believe, Superman Last Family of Krypton, which was a 3-issue miniseries, which it was never collected, but if you can find those 3 issues... definitely pick him up because it's a really, really fun story. Maybe if we could maybe do a podcast on that sometime. That's a really good series. It's a really good book.
So the creative team here, as we said, it's Kurt Busiek and Stuart Immonen. Busiek at this point is obviously a known quantity. He's got Marvels under his belt. He's got Untold Tales of Spider-Man. He's got his whole Avengers run, which is over at this point. He's got JLA Avengers, and Astro City has been running for a few years at this point. Immonen, on the other hand, he got his big break in the early 90s helping Mark Waid to reboot the Legion of Superheroes, did a lot of Legion stuff.
Did he do Legionnaires?
No, Legionnaires was, I forget the guy's name, it was like this very cartoony artist. And Immonen also did a lot of Superman work in the late 90s, so this is his return to the character after like 4 years or so not working, and Busiek and Immonen together had previously worked on the indie book Shock Rockets. Which I don't really has something to do with jetpacks, I think. I don't really know anything.
I mostly know Stuart Immonen from his work with Bendis on some new Avengers stuff and from All New X-Men.
Yeah, after this he did some work with Bendis, but then before the Bendis stuff, he did some like Ultimate Universe stuff. He did a run on Ultimate X-Men and a run on Ultimate Fantastic Four, and I think he did one of the arcs at like the very end of Ultimate Peter Parker. Once Bagley had left, once they broke Stan and Jack's record. So this book, the concept for this is inspired by Superboy Prime, who first appeared in DC Comics Presents 87 during Crisis on Infinite Earths. And basically Superboy Prime, it's basically the same as this, which we'll get into more obviously in a second. But Superboy Prime is, what if on an alternate Earth, it's like, quote unquote, the real Earth, which of course, once you write it in a fictional story, that's pointless at that point. But it's like a very realistic Earth. No one has superpowers except for one guy who's basically Superman. And it was just part of the Crisis on Infinite Earths thing. And then it basically became something no one talked about because obviously Superboy, you don't talk about that. And the multiverse, you don't talk about that for the next like 15 years. But then Geoff Johns also ruined Superboy Prime by making him just this like asshole. And he kills people to death.
But so the basic premise of this book, Superman's Secret Identity, basically it takes place on this Earth where there's no superheroes, but they exist in, you know, comics much like ours. And some family from Kansas thinks it's a great idea to name their son Clark, with their last name being Kent.
Her to her.
So of course he gets bullied all of his life, and he, you know, hates it at first, but eventually, he kind of randomly discovers that he actually has the powers of Superman.
Yeah, he also gets all this, like, Superman memorabilia that he just stuffs in his closet, and he kind of hates it. And, like,
he has a suit.
He, like, talks about how he kind of goes along with it and stuff, and he tells his parents that he doesn't like it. But I feel like even to this extent,
I don't think he ever told his parents he doesn't like it.
Well,
they like subtly know.
Yeah,
I'm sure they do.
But like, I think when they start showing like how he's getting like action figures like every single year for Christmas, I'm like, that's a little over the top. Like, you'd have to be a real dick of an uncle to play that joke every year until your nephew's like
18. For the Clark Kent in this book, it follows him until he probably dies. As far as first issues go, I don't think the issue really started. I don't think the story really started to get going until he got his powers.
I think it's a little bit of a slow start.
I think it's mostly just introduction to this, you know, Clark Kent as a person. It's a lot of introspective. All of the narration is him typing on a typewriter. So it's told from his point of view, more or less.
Right.
And I think most of the first issue is just to set up how his life is. And like we already mentioned, there's a lot of, like, getting bullied by, maybe not bullied per se, but, like, definitely not liking his family's attitudes or jokes towards his name. But he is straight up bullied at school, and
he's bullied by like that one person. I don't think it's like.
I think
everything else I would call it playful teasing.
I think there's also a decent amount of ostracizing.
Yeah.
And he picks that out himself, or Clark, that is, kind of talks about that a lot, and he talks about it throughout the book more or less. But he basically always he feels most at home, or most himself when he's alone. So a lot of the book is him just going out to some scenic vista and thinking.
Yeah, what's funny is, like, because everyone teases him all the time, he gets to hang out with the nerds, and they show, like, a cafeteria scene. Yeah. But he can't even escape it with them, where one of his friends asks him if Wonder Girl technically counts as the Teen Titans founder. And she was not there in Brave and the Bold 54, though the team doesn't officially form until 60,
cut,
where Donna technically does first appear and joins the team. But yeah, him flying, it's 10 pages in, so it's like a quarter of the way through the first issue. So I don't think it really starts that slow. And honestly, like, I don't know if you guys agree, but the more human moments, like the parts where it's more about like this alternate Earth Clark Kent and less about his powers are the parts that are more interesting to me in this book.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
I don't think he starts very likable at first either.
No, he doesn't. He does seem to wallow in his own self-pity a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very obvious that, and we said this and he talks about this, where he feels very detached. And like later he becomes a writer, and it's a little bit different to Clark Kent. We'll get to that.
His boss mentions it in his writing that it feels like that he's not human.
Yeah. He's like has a unique perspective, and it's because like he can fly and look down at the Earth from space. But also like they explain what kind of books he's writing, and it's like this really heady, like esoteric stuff where he's like talking about how like foot traffic and how that's a metaphor for global politics and all kinds of like weird metaphor, like lofty ideas that he uses in his writing.
But he develops his powers and he's like, well, this is kind of fun. And he starts talking to a reporter.
Correct.
So
I believe he starts off just flying around and kind of just taking insights. And then at some point or another, he comes across natural disasters and stuff like that and decides to help people. I think the first thing was the town over from him got flooded and he was just, you know, out flying like on his lunch break from school or something like that. And so he saw the situation, thought, I shouldn't have people see me. I think people look good. There's National Guard down there and stuff. And then this one person on a car is about to get swept into the river.
Yeah.
And he's like, well, shit, I can't just let that guy die. So he saves him, does it super fast so that it's nothing more than a blur. But nevertheless, people start to see him and start talking about him. And eventually he goes to a reporter saying, I'll let you break this story if I can trust you.
Which he catches her videotaping him. So he's like, well, I can't trust you. And he gets really angry. But he decides to go to the state fair dressed as Superboy.
This is on Halloween.
Yeah.
In his head, he thinks it's a clever joke or whatever.
Well, he was ready to publicly reveal it that night. That was
the plan. Oh, yeah, that was the plan. You're right.
He was going to try to impress that girl.
Mm-hmm.
I think he was just going to reveal it to her personally. And then
there's a
second where he's going to reveal it publicly. But then it turns out there was a giant explosion and the reporter caused it. And when he realizes that she did it, he's like, I'm not going to reveal it publicly. Mm-hmm. So he basically fakes not having powers.
I thought that was a pretty cool scene.
Yeah,
I like that.
And it's really cool how, like, then like you see like a newspaper story where it's like Superboy hoax, and like a lot of like it increases the teasing, but at the same time he still basically becomes a hero for his town, just not a superhero.
And at this point it's where he doesn't feel quite so alienated by all of his, you know, school friends or whatever, because while they still tease him, it's a bit less, I think, now. And also, he doesn't necessarily care that much because he can fly.
Well, it's like wink, wink, nudge, nudge for like them. Like, hey, we know you actually did save people. So,
I'd like to mention there is some levity in this book, though. It's not like all bullying and like introspective angst. There's a scene that I really like where he acknowledges that he tried to spy on girls in the locker room, but he stops not because that's ethically wrong, but because he has no idea how his x-ray vision works, so he's wondering if he's accidentally going to give all these girls cancer. And that comes up later in a later issue. But, I mean, we basically addressed the whole first issue. The end, we learn that the government is looking into him, but initially they're looking into this mysterious superhero character who looks like Superman. But we learn that they looked into this Clark Kent kid, but they crossed him off the list because he broke his leg when he was a kid, so it's probably not him.
Right.
And another cool thing we should mention is that all the issues have titles.
Yeah.
So the first one, I believe, is Smallville, and then the second one, which we'll move into now, is Metropolis. Mm-hmm. And it kind of reminds me of, you know, that's the whole journey that Clark Kent takes where – I mean, the first one, which we don't really get his – well, we do get his full backstory here, but he has a different origin from the Superman we all know. So there's no Krypton chapter, but usually it would be, you know, Krypton, Smallville, Metropolis, and stuff like that. But there's no Krypton here, and there's nothing after Metropolis in the traditional narrative, really. So the third and fourth, when we get to them, they're slightly different.
So going into issue two, we've jumped further in time, where Clark, I'm guessing he's like, what, in his early 20s?
Yeah, this is probably his first job out of college. He's working for the New York Times?
No, the New Yorker.
New Yorker.
He's like a special pieces writer at the New Yorker. And so, I mean, granted, this is
probably like 26.
This is probably, at this point, we're probably pretty close to the book's publication because he's born, or no, I think he's born in like the... like mid early 80s maybe,
because earlier mid 80s, like 82, 80, between 82 and 86 maybe.
Well, because it discusses later the way he gets his powers is meteorites, and those fall in 88. So he was and I think he was 13 then. So he's like late 70s born.
So like 78, 79.
So we're probably in the early 90s here. We should stop doing too much math. What about if he was
born in 78 when the Superman the movie came out?
Yeah, I mean that could have been part of the choice.
That could be the reason why they named him that.
But he likes to note that he's not a reporter like Clark Kent. He's just a writer. He's not on the beat. He's doing these weird heady pieces, like
and,
I said.
And his coworkers still tease him with Superman cards.
Yeah, that's a good point to mention that. I really like how Stuart Immonen, he uses like these like retro styles in a lot of these moments where there's Superman memorabilia. Or, like, someone gives him a card. And some of it is, like, if it's a card, like, it's in context within the story. But also a lot of the issues open with that. And sometimes it's more, like, metaphorical. And he's using, like, the Ben Day dot style and everything here, like, artificially to evoke that golden and silver age Superman. And near the end, not spoiling anything too much, but near the end it comes full circle where... they use the same style for Clark's own flashbacks within the story, which I thought was super cool. Like when I saw that, I was like, wow, that's awesome.
And he stops a plane from going down. And this is where the art really starts to get awesome. I mean, it was really good in the first issue, but like his landscape, Stuart Immonen's landscape shots are really, really good.
They are.
Like when he draws all of New York City in like that half page splash, it's really awesome. But he stops the plane and he's wearing a Superman costume while he does this.
He still kind of operates in the whole realm of, I'm going to try and make sure no one really sees me. And all the while, we get little snippets that the government is still trying to figure out who's behind things like him rescuing the plane. I think they say something along the lines of, well, we can see handprints in the metal where someone clearly grabbed this, but there's no fingerprints we can get, so...
But the main thrust of issue two is that his friends try and set him up with a woman named Lois.
Yes.
Nice gag. And he tells us that he's been set up with 18 Loises, 7 Lanas, and 1 Cat Grant.
That Cat Grant was only because... But only his roommate did that because only he thought it funny.
Yeah, Clark in the story has no idea who Cat Grant is.
Yeah, for those who don't, Cat Grant is a fellow reporter at the my notes say the Bugle, at the Daily Planet.
To say Cat Grant is a fellow reporter at the Daily Planet.
Yeah,
at
the Daily Planet, and she was introduced to bring back that love triangle aspect, which kind of had faded away since Lana was more attached to Pete Ross. And was kind of not part of that
Metropolis gang. Well, Lana married Pete Ross.
Yeah, eventually, yeah. I'm not sure, precisely sure when they got married.
I know that they get married and have a kid, and their kid has, like, problems with, like, after birth, and Superman has to take the baby and fly it across the country to a better hospital, and all at the same time he has to fight Doomsday again. It's a pretty fun story. It's in the Doomsday omnibus.
So the thing here is... I don't know that I've met more than 2 Loises in my entire life. How do you find 18 Loises? Like,
I don't think I've ever met a Lois.
I can't say I've met a Lois either, come to think.
Like, just like when we say that and then like we're gonna like go back and be like, oh, we have like there's someone in our family.
No, we're gonna Lois. No, we're all gonna
closest
we're all gonna
I got is
someone,
Luis.
We're all gonna meet someone named Lois like in 3 days.
Week, yeah.
I have a friend that goes by Cat, but not Cat Grant.
I also know a girl that goes by Cat.
And this is like the early 90s, so it's not even like they can like type Lois into Facebook and just message like, hey, I have this cool friend. I want to say hello.
I still think it's funny for the gag.
Yeah, it's funny.
It's fun. It works.
But the main thing is that they get set up on a blind date. And they're both kind of pissed about it because they've had this happen.
But she storms off.
Oh, yeah, no. Literally the second that Lois figures out the guy's name is Clark, she just turns and leaves.
Which is very weird that she's getting set up with Clarks.
I mean, like we said, it's still not a super common name. Like,
well, wait, would Lois and Clark be on the air at this point?
I mean, I'm not sure, but...
Either way...
But regardless, I mean, Lois is like more of a unique name than Clark. So even though she doesn't have the last name, she might get similar jokes all the time. But defying the odds, they do fall in love. They just roll with it. But he feels guilty about not telling her about his powers. So he's going to come back to that at some point. But
I believe they start dating for a few months.
Yeah.
Then at some point he decides on like a Friday, he says something along the lines of, all right, she's out of town with work until like Tuesday. I'll tell her Tuesday night.
Yeah. But first he has to stop this boat that's sinking in the middle of the ocean.
But as Admiral Akbar would say, it's a trap. And
by the government.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he gets ambushed and they abduct him.
They shoot him with this electric weapon.
And then there's all this, like, also here, like, we talked about the cityscapes and everything. Immonen has, like, a wide array of style throughout the book. Like, he changes his style based on the tone of what's happening at that moment and everything like that. Like, this is really, like, a real showing for Immonen's skills. But so he's in these labs and getting tested and all this stuff and allows also some good intercutting of some classic Superman references where they show Brainiac and Lex. He's having nightmares and stuff. And like, there's a lot of stuff hinted here where it's like, does the government have other superpowers? Like, are there other people that they've abducted, or are they trying to give powers to other people to replicate the process? And you never really fully get the answer in this story, which I think was fine. It was good. And then we get a panel where he bursts out of a test tube, and it's kind of reminiscent of those chain-breaking shots.
Yep. So the while he was in that test tube, the government had him sedated and was running tests on him. And I think they explained it a little later, but supposedly, like, the sedative they were using, like, he got acclimated to it or something like that. Some deus ex machina where he can bust out at in, like, the middle of the night when no guards are there. And as he's walking by, he sees a bunch of toe tags and eventually, like, a baby.
Yeah, it's so disturbing.
He, understandably, is super pissed and just wrecks the entire place.
It's kind of like Mewtwo.
Yeah, actually very similar to that now that I think about it.
I don't know what that is.
It's a Pokemon.
What?
Danny DeVito, small little yellow rat.
But yeah,
yes.
He escapes, and obviously the experience really freaked him out, and this is where he starts getting really detached for a good period. And he starts wearing glasses, but it's not to like hide his identity from all the people actually close to him. It's just in case a secret agent recognizes him, which I thought, again, was an interesting twist on.
He goes further of it. Well, I mean, we'll get there, but when he, like, reveals himself to the government and tries to part, he goes even further with it. Yeah. We'll mention what he does when we get there.
Yeah, but so he, this, like I said, he was figured out he was going to tell Lois about his powers on, like, a Friday or something, and he gets captured, and he stays, I think, a few days, so he gets back, like, Monday or so, and had to explain himself at work. And then, like, calls out sick for a week or so because he's just in his house, like, paranoid.
Yeah, he and freaking called and out. Said that his dad was sick and he had to, like, run back home.
Yeah, yeah. And so eventually he leaves because he has to do laundry.
Yeah, and meanwhile, he also kind of distances himself from Lois for a little bit, but then eventually gets back with her. And, yeah.
So for a while, he's, after he, you know, sees Lois again, he's kind of acting more aloof than he used to have been, and she's asking if it's about, you know, his dad, which, of course, his dad's actually fine, but she doesn't know that, and I think he got a book deal at some point, so she asks him if it's about that, and he kind of snaps at her and is like, I can't really do this, and just kind of leaves.
Yeah, he has a breakdown.
And so I believe he goes off and helps people for a couple months.
But he, like, he's paying very close attention to when he does it because, like, he can now start to spot when things are being set up.
Yeah. And so after a while, he tries to reconcile with Lois by with a picnic, good old-fashioned picnic.
Picnic on the roof, and then he tells her to open his shirt, and it's like, oh, he's wearing a Superman shirt. And I thought this was hilarious because it's played like she thinks it's like this weird sex roleplay thing. And, like, that would have been hilarious, but it's like, oh, no, he's flying.
Yeah, he tells her to look down, and then it's like the classic, like, oh, no, she's actually there up in the air flying. And you get another great city shot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He gives her a tour of the world, of the U.S., whatever. They have fun, kind of talk about it a little bit. And I thought it was funny. She's like, I shoplifted once, so we both have secrets, so I got you.
Yeah. They go to North Carolina for crabs or something.
Yeah, he's like, I like that, like, with all of his free time, like, in college, he figured out, like,
yeah,
like, the best, like, seafood. Was it, like, this one little shack? And then he's like, yeah, I go here from time to time.
Yeah. It's pretty neat to see how, like, an everyday person would use Superman's powers, because that's totally something I would do if I was hungry, just like, I wonder what's good in, like, Arizona.
Yeah, like, hey, I just want some Kansas City barbecue. Boom, there.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the first chapter was Smallville, second was Metropolis, and then the third is the Fortress of Solitude, where he's fully grown up, and he's settling down.
He's married, and him and Lois are building a house. That's the basis for the third issue.
They're building a house in Maine, I believe.
They're both, like, super successful all of a sudden between chapters. Yeah. He's got multiple books under his belt.
One of them being used as a college... I don't know, wait, that might be what... Yeah,
that was this one.
Yeah, it's going to be used as a college textbook.
Yeah, it's like an intro to, like, system analysis or something.
Which was unintended.
Like, yeah. Super, like, engineering. Like, I'm taking a class on system dynamics, and I don't know how the fuck he accidentally wrote a textbook on that, but good for him.
She moved...
He is Superman.
She moved from an interior designer, and now she's, like, this consultant on giant, like, design stuff.
I think she owns her own company at this point, right?
Yeah. And I believe he has a Pulitzer, which is very quickly mentioned at some point.
I always thought that he just went to the Pulitzer dinner for his friend, and it was his friend that won.
Oh, that could be. I thought his friend's name was his editor.
He went to it for a friend.
Is all of like a panel where he's just like, the Pulitzer dinner was nice.
So he's meanwhile this whole time he's been keeping up his superheroics, and he always arises from the Boston Harbor, which is interesting because that's where Kurt Busiek is from.
Yeah, there's a couple pages of all of his like paranoid little ways to trick the government. Like, you know, we said he's building a house in Maine. He like dug out a hollowed tree like all the way to the ocean, and then he'll swim a few hundred miles from Maine to Boston, where he'll surface in the Boston Bay. And he'll always come from like one way where the government hasn't set up little motion sensors.
Yeah.
And a recurring thing that happens is whenever he's like, you know, going to a place or whatever, he'll mention like, yeah, the government would put these like little
he started sensors to notice or something. It over time. And he's
like, I see them from, you know, orbit. Like, they can't fool me.
I got another numbers nitpick here. At one point, he's describing all the great things he's done over the year, and he says, including over 200 plane and car crashes, which I feel are totally different in terms of the lives you're saving. So I would separate those when you're listing off your feats. Because a plane crash, when you prevent that, you're saving 100 people. Car crash, max 7.
Depends on where the car is. If it's on a highway.
If it's a pileup, it could be a lot. Yeah. But you are correct. They are kind of different.
And his big project at the moment is he's trying to fix all the corrupt and trafficked aids, not financial aid and
supplies,
food and stuff like that, that in Africa.
Mm-hmm. So he plays a little Robin Hood with the supplies that the government sends, because I think it's the corrupt government in Africa will take them and then
they'll sell them on the black market.
Yeah, so he'll just Robin Hood himself in, steal stuff and give them to the people that need it.
Yeah, that is an actual common thing, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm. He keeps a little scrapbook of all the
we're just flipping through the book, and just like there's a beautiful.
And then I'm trying to find the card, but basically he gets a card. I think it might be in the beginning.
It's the intro.
It's right here.
It's a picture of Superman, Superboy, Supergirl, and Crypto.
Which doesn't make sense because these are the same person.
It really doesn't, again, this is the real world. I doubt someone that is an expert in
comics. I could totally see this card being a thing.
Yeah.
It definitely is.
But Superman has a cake and is like, come on, everyone, we've got to get there in time.
Yeah, so his wife gives him a Superman family card, which is, of course, referencing all the spinoffs that Dan just named. But the logo used here was used for the Superman Family comic, which ran from 74 to 82, which merged the Supergirl, Jimmy Olsen, and Lois Lane titles. Mm-hmm. And the big reveal here is Lois says, oh, Superman Family.
Like, you didn't catch that one?
You didn't catch that there? Like, I'm pregnant.
Yep.
And he's...
You're going to be a super dad.
Oh, also, I think it's like a very throwaway thing here at some point, but he mentions how he can get blood tests and get his hair cut, but he can reflect bullets, and that's one of those like one of those eternal Superman questions where it's like, you know, there's a classic like Silver Age cover where it's like the guy's trying to cut Superman's hair and his mm-hmm. scissors break and stuff like that, and it's like, how does he shave? He has to use his laser vision with a mirror and stuff like that, and they kind of just hand wave that, which I mean, that's the best way you can do
it. How does Clark Kent pass his yearly physical for the Daily Planet?
You just don't worry about it.
But yes,
I want that issue. Brian Michael Bendis, answer it.
But so the big, like the main thing, or one of the two main things about chapter 3 is that he's going to be a dad. And he's, you know, over the moon at first, and then eventually starts, you know, having a paranoid breakdown. The logical questions
you have to ask, like
are they going to be okay? Are they going to be mutants? Are they going to be like me? Are they going to be fine?
Is the government he's gonna be more cautious now because I'm a dad now, I can't take as much risk.
And then he's like, well, what if the government gets me? And he's like, what if the government gets my kid? Oh my god.
And he decides that the best course of action would be to reveal himself and try to strike a partnership.
Yep. To the government, that is.
Yeah, to the government.
Yeah, so he purposely falls into like one of the most obvious traps in a while at the Hoover Dam. And his offer is, hey, I'll work with you guys. But it can't be political, no coups, no nothing like that. And
like really under the table kind of thing.
Yeah. And then, of course, they cross him. So he just fucks off. But then he starts screwing with them. I love this.
Oh, God, it's a great couple
pages. It's awesome. He leaves, like, Superman comics in the White House briefing packets. He, like, switches the nukes on carriers. All kinds of screwing around. But I thought it was interesting. It's like a throwaway line, but when he's talking about this nuke switching thing, he considers, I could have switched out all the nukes for butter, but that would leave our national security at a risk.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, I mean, that's like something like you would expect from Superman. It's like, he's still a good guy. He's still an American, even if he's screwing around with the government.
Except, you know, Superman 4, the quest for peace, when he, you know, takes all of the nuclear weapons and throws them into space.
Yep. So while he's off on his little prank spree, he leaves the main agent that's been tasked with bringing him in. His name,
Malloy.
He leaves him a little note saying, meet me at this, you know, latitude on this day, and we'll talk. And it happens to be the Washington Monument. Mostly so that there can't be a firefight.
Yeah, and pretty smart.
Yep.
Like Mike was saying earlier, Clark goes to great lengths to change his appearance. He gets little, like, insert things to, like, make his nose a little bigger.
He stuffs in his cheeks, which is what Marlon Brando famously did in Godfather to change his appearance.
Mm. But yeah, it's just little things to tweak his appearance just a little bit. I think he uses color contacts. And he mentions it later in the book, but he does this all the time whenever he wears the Superman suit at this point. And
it's not exhausting.
Yeah, he's got super speed, probably. It's probably okay.
But yeah, this is a really good conversation where he basically explains he understands the government's afraid of him. They want a contingency plan if he ever goes against their interests, if he goes crazy, something like that. But he's not an enemy unless they make him one. And they're making him one by trying to capture him all the time and stuff like that.
Like, yeah,
and
just let me help.
His whole argument is like, look at what I did the past week. How much to harm did I do? None.
None.
Exactly. Would you like me to? Because you now know I clearly could.
It's like, how much of a harm have I done for the last 10 years?
Yeah.
None.
So they finally accept his offer. And so now he's essentially an occasional contractor for the U.S. government.
They do stick to their word of mostly calling him in for natural disaster type things. Every once in a while, they'll still try and, like, plant a booby trap and... He'll just, you know, see it when he's coming in, just destroy everything, hand it back to Malloy, and be like, tell him the line, sir.
Like, come on, man.
So, this goes on for a while.
But he's called for a major emergency right when Lois is about to give birth. But he wants to stick to his promise, so he goes for it. And we also failed to mention so far that Lois also is going to have twins.
And the...
Twin girls.
The main reason... It's a neat little exchange between him and Lois as they're, like, in the hospital and she's about to, you know, pop two kids out of her. She's like, oh, God, Malloy's calling. Yeah. Like, I have to go. Like, people might die. And she understands, and he hates not being there. But one of the cool things he does is he is listening the entire time.
Yeah, like, he's using superhero hearing.
So the actual mission, it's him stopping some multinational terrorist organization that's trying to take over South America and set off a nuke underground. And, like, there's some kind of interesting commentary here where he's like, I'm still saving lives, even if this is going against what I wanted. Like, it's kind of a political thing. But honestly, this was the least, like, interesting part of the book to me. Like, I liked they're intercutting it with the Lois in the hospital stuff. And, like, that's obviously...
It felt very much like... I mean, John was born in the Batcave of Flashpoint Batman, but I can totally see, like, let's say if, like, Flashpoint didn't ruin everything and we still had regular Superman, and they did go through with, like, the storyline of, like, Convergence, or at least, like, the Superman part of, like, having a kid, you can totally see, like, this totally happening to Superman.
Yeah. But just the one thing that I, like, kind of took away from the whole, like, these, you know, terrorists all trying to destabilize South America or whatever... Clark the entire time is saying, if they just let me do this a week ago, this would have been much easier. It's like, they just backed me into a corner here.
Yep.
But, I mean, basically he saves the day and then the twins are born and he's going to protect them no matter what.
Yep.
And there's a great final page where he's holding his daughters with Lois in the hospital bed.
So the last page is like a big splash page.
Mm-hmm.
And so, then chapter 4 is tomorrow.
Chapter 4 tomorrow.
And this probably our biggest time skip.
Yeah, like, this is huge.
But
yeah,
also, so within this chapter, we get a lot of time skips as well.
Yeah, so last we left off on the Kent family, the girls were literally just born. Now they're both in their mid-20s.
Yeah,
it's... Clark here is 57.
It's like the moment in, what's the movie? Interstellar, where...
Yeah.
Where Matthew McConaughey watches his kids literally grow up.
Yeah, but so, the Superman-related...
I liked this.
Art style thing. It's kind of reminiscent of the animated series Bruce Timm.
Yeah, it's Bruce Timm style.
And it's a Superman figure. You find out later it's an ornament because it's Christmas time and he's holding an hourglass and a scythe and he has this big Santa beard. It says Happy New Year. Honestly, the scythe, a little morbid, but I feel like that's just a thing from New Year's stuff. And, you know, of course, you know, his entire life people have been like poking fun at the whole Clark Kent thing. And now his 20-something-year-old daughters are doing it to him, too.
Oh, he says they've been doing it to him every Christmas.
Every Christmas. And this one is like, see, it's got a beard, Dad, so it can remind you of your mortality. Like, thanks. Yep, I'm going to die one day. Thanks, girls.
Thank you.
Yeah, but we see a lot of how his family dynamic has evolved, and his daughters have grown up, and they all have their own lives at this point.
I think this was my favorite issue, by the way.
Yeah, I think parts of it. I think, for me, like, it's like the first and the last. And his powers are kind of fading, and I thought a hilarious part is he tries to go get recharged in front of the sun.
Yeah.
Like Superman
off. It just gives him a really, 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 like, he gets really, really tan.
Yeah. It's pretty funny. But one of the interesting things, and kind of going back to the whole, whenever he wants to think, he just goes somewhere where he can be alone, which initially, before he got powers, was some nearby state park, but after he got his powers, he would just... fly over cities or fly off to wherever.
Fly off to the mountains.
So you find out here that every Christmas, he'll at some point in the night say, hey, we're going to go stand outside for a while. Yep. Lois will come out and like talk to him for a little bit, and then he'll just go up basically into space and just look at the world for a bit. But yeah, so he goes up into space just to look, think. He kind of surveys the world, and he says something along the lines of, nothing out of the usual today. Everyone's doing pretty well, which is kind of nice.
Peace on Earth. Goodwill to all men.
So not as cool as what the real Superman does on Christmas, which if you read Funeral for a Friend, he apparently every Christmas Superman runs gifts to all of the needy children, and answers their Christmas lists and buys it for them. And in Funeral for a Friend, Superman can't do it. The Justice League has to keep up, and even with the whole power of the Justice League, they could match the one output that Superman does. I remember that issue.
But, so like Vince was saying, his powers are starting to wane a little bit. He's still super strong and can fly and stuff, and he, like, lifts up Ultra with one arm, and Lois is like, ha, old my ass. And he's like, yeah, I used to be able to do that with, like, 10 of those. I might feel that in the morning tomorrow now.
Yeah.
And so at this point, I think by now it's explicitly stated that Clark and Lois their children don't have powers.
That they know of.
That they know of.
They don't believe, and there's some interesting stuff where they show them like kind of testing their kids when they were growing up.
Like very subtly trying to test, but they.
It's like, here, lift this thing. It's like, Daddy, it's too heavy.
Yeah.
And it was like funny, but then they're also like, oh, that
this
that
is
was
wrong.
Like, like Clark specifically says, like, we kind of needed to do it, but it was like. Really weird, basically making
our
kids
uncomfortable
lab rats.
With it. Yeah.
So they just kind of stopped after a while because they didn't really show any signs of having powers when they were growing up.
What's really weird is he never revealed that he had powers to them.
Correct. At this point, the only person he is told that he has powers is Lois.
Yeah, his parents don't even know.
Yeah, and meanwhile, he's kind of become a conspiracy theorist. He's obsessed with all the sightings of himself and. There's been this subplot in this issue where it's kind of like, oh, maybe the government has other superpowered agents. And he learns, like, maybe it had to do with this meteor strike in 1988 that somehow affected the water or something. And so maybe there are other people like him around.
Mm-hmm. He is still working for the government every once in a while, still with Malloy. And... I think he says at some point he doesn't know whether or not to get him a scotch on his birthday because they've kind of become friends. throughout like the decades that they've been working together, but he still doesn't quite trust Malloy.
It's very weird. I don't think they just became like two guys that worked together for a long time. They didn't even become like friends or not.
There is a neat little exchange where he like drops some, I don't know, some sensor equipment on his desk, and Malloy's just like, oh yeah, I got some new guys in. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
Like, clearly, like, Malloy's kind of sick of that shit,
too. Yeah, he's like, enough of this.
But, so, like Vince was saying, he does a lot of conspiracy theory stuff. I think one of the cooler scenes was he just kind of hovered above the Pentagon and just telescopic X-ray vision into some files and was like, well, I can't really use this information, but I have it.
Yep. Then,
but the major moment here is he's trying to deal with some tornado and he sees two little specks
and laughter, and he hears laughter.
Yeah.
So he
kind of assumes that maybe it's his daughters.
And so he concocts this little plan because he talks to Lois about it and is like, should we ask them about it? And I think it's Lois saying, well, we're their parents. We should probably do that. And Clark's, you know, having gone through this himself, says, I think we should let them come to us with it if they want to. We could maybe nudge them along, but I don't think we should out their secret.
Yep.
Yeah, which I thought that was a really cool conversation.
I like that.
Mm-hmm. And that's, again, something where it's like you can take that metaphorically as well and apply it to other situations.
Mm-hmm. But so what Clark does is he leaves out a manuscript. He says that his daughters always like to like leaf through them and read them, and I think it's all the conspiracy stuff, or maybe
it's his journal that he's been writing the whole book.
It's the journal he's been keeping, like all the narration, and he just leaves it out on the table and goes to bed early with Lois. And in the morning, I think they both leave.
And he like uses his X-ray vision
He doesn't try and see if it's been like moved.
Oh, I thought he did. No, okay.
He like specifically avoids it because he wants them to go to it.
That's right. He said he wanted to, but he doesn't do it.
Yep.
And then we get one of his cooler feats.
No, this was awesome.
This was dope.
He stops a derailed bullet train, and he's, you know, it's this giant bullet train on like the side of a mountain.
It's got like 10 cars on it.
Yeah, it's going, he describes it's going like 600 miles per hour or something.
He says, like, you ever try reversing out of your driveway? Me stopping this is like doing that. But I have 20 trailers, and I'm going 600 miles an hour, and I have to do it perfectly the first time.
Yeah.
And so he's saying how, like, 10, even 2 years ago, this would have been a piece of cake.
Yeah, this is not easy.
Kind of struggling. And then all of a sudden, it becomes easier, and he sees that, like, the train's been segmented into thirds, and then his two daughters are just there in super person costumes, like, hey, Dad.
Yeah. Literally, what's up?
Like, the first thing is one... Yeah, his one daughter, the first thing he says after, like, they both reveal these secrets to each other.
Yeah, you gotta teach me that.
How'd you do that, Dad? That's so cool. Like, and the other sister's like, that's the first thing you want to ask him, how he stopped the train just now.
I don't know, I felt like that was very real. Like,
oh, that, like, totally seems like a dad, like a father-daughter thing.
And that, the shot of all three of them flying over the mountains is just so great.
Yeah. And so after this, I think they go home, tell Lois, because she still didn't know for sure at this point. And I think Malloy retires.
Yeah, Malloy retires. He reveals he knows who Clark was, and he's known it for a while. But they kind of go, both of them, like, it's the same thing where he's like, maybe I should get him the scotch, but it's like, he was an asshole to me and stuff like that. But Malloy's like, hey, if I had known about the test tube thing, I'd like to think I would have tried to stop it. So they kind of depart on, like, kind of still uneasy.
They depart on pretty good terms. Malloy tells him.
More good than bad.
Yeah. Like, this is going to be it for you with the government as well. Like, there's no one that's going to take over my job as your handler or anything. Yeah.
You're free to do what you want.
Like, don't worry. I won't tell anyone who you are.
And we get another Christmas scene, and the main thing here is that the girls steal his tradition from him so he can be with his wife.
Mm-hmm.
I like this.
And then we get a huge flash forward, and now he has gray hair.
He's a grandfather now.
He's got his beard, and the narration changes from typewriter to some digital format, and they acknowledge that there are no typewriter ribbons available anymore.
Yeah, he couldn't fix it anymore.
I think he said, like, he could make more. He just really didn't feel like it.
And now superheroes are in the open. They work for the government. And I don't think this was necessary, but it's not really fully addressed. Like, do other governments have them? Are there any ones that are, like, assholes? Like, are there villains in this universe? It's not central to the story at all, but, like, those were questions that were coming to my head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you, so he continues going on with how his powers have been continuing to wane, but his family's been growing.
Yeah,
he has, I think, two grandsons and another on the way or something like that.
I think there may be some time skips, but they reference three total because there's Clark and Jimmy, mm-hmm. which are younger, and there's Perry, who we see later, and Perry's the right. one who's started to show off his powers, and so he hangs out with his mother, his aunt, and his grandfather.
Mm-hmm. But you gotta.
He's gotta wear an insulated suit now.
Yeah, because he starts getting cold when he goes flying up in orbit.
Yep. And then Vince, you want to talk about the changing art styles again, where it's kind of where we see like the flashback, where it mirrors the flashbacks, but it also is a kind of a shout out, an acknowledgement to every like distinct era of Superman stylistic looks.
Yeah, we. Like I said earlier, they now incorporate that flashback Benday dots retro style into his own flashback, so it all comes full circle. And then we get kind of peeks at like some animated style looks with Bruce Timm and others. I feel like it would have been really interesting to see like a very distinct, like I couldn't necessarily tell you like, oh, this is this artist, this is this artist.
Mm.
But
yeah, like I felt like the one up here, the one up in the left hand corner on this page, like that was maybe supposed to be Jurgens or / John Byrne kind of look.
Yeah.
You get the sense of distinct eras, maybe decades, but you definitely don't quite get a specific artist.
Yeah, which is fine.
It still works as intended.
It still looks really cool.
And his final book that he writes is about the dawn of the superheroes, people with powers, but he doesn't include himself and the kids.
Or his family, because he still likes to have his privacy.
Yeah. He likes
secret
his privacy.
Secret identity.
And then one of my favorite scenes, this is another one that you can take metaphorically, is...
Oh, yeah, this is a great scene.
He's above the earth again. He's also chilling with that Christmas ornament from earlier. Which I guess he leaves as a space litter.
I think so.
but he notes how basically everyone has their own secret identity. And maybe it's that you have superpowers, maybe not. Everyone has their kind of secrets.
Mm-hmm. And the nice little one of the ending things here is he's watching the sunset as he does this. And one of the narrations is, I find myself watching a lot of sunsets. And he said that before. It's kind of metaphorical for, like, dying and stuff like that, because sunsets. But one of the really cool things is he's, you know, monologuing to himself, basically, about what Vince was saying. And he says, and that's the thing about sunsets. They're majestic, stately, lovely, and inevitable. And then, a little ways to the east, there's a sunrise.
Yep. Which is a thing, like, he talks about how he would go watch sunsets, and, like, that's one of the things he'd do when he in his solidarity. So mm-hmm. It kind of brings everything full circle.
Yeah. It's a nice little huge symbolism, metaphor, stuff like that thing at the end.
Yep.
It's very hopeful.
Yep. As any Superman book should be.
Yeah, correct. And bringing things full circle, the way I was reading it digitally, so the dedications were in the final issue at the end. I believe in the trade, they're just in the beginning. But the book was dedicated to Elliot S. Magan, Kurt Swan, and Julia Schwartz, which were the team on the original Superboy Prime.
Yeah, that's right here.
Yep.
And they were also, just in general, three major contributors to the pre-crisis history of Superman. But, like, this might be honestly, I've thought about it since I just reread it. This might be my favorite standalone Superman story, like, outside of the regular continuity.
Whew. I don't know about that for me. I'd say for me it still has to be All-Star.
I mean, I think this book is much more about Clark Kent, and you could say All-Star focuses more on Superman, where All-Star, each issue is kind of about a different part of the Superman mythology, where you have different kinds of villains. You have the Bizarro issue. You have the Jimmy with the signal watch, and basically All-Star's own take on Doomsday. And then Secret Identity, it's much more about the character of Clark Kent. In fact, like we said, you don't even get any of that Krypton stuff.
Like almost all also like the psychology of being Superman, which
is
prevalent in a lot of Superman stories and like Elseworlds. But I think in here it's very noticeable, but not in a heavy-handed, beating it into you kind of way.
No, it's a really good book, and it's a book I've always wanted to read for a really, really long time, because like DC always has the check if you like this, here's these other Superman stories. And it's one of the ones that's always in the back of there being advertised. Mm-hmm. I remember like back then, this used to be in two volumes.
Yeah.
Which is ridiculous.
That's crazy, yeah.
Like I said, it's not technically an Elseworlds, but, you know.
Might as well be.
Yeah.
It basically is. So it's an Elseworlds, but what I like is it still keeps the spirit of Superman, like we said, which different kinds of alternate universe stories, sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. So this still feels like a Superman story in a way that, like, the other example would be, like, Injustice. Injustice, I wouldn't call a Superman story.
No.
Yeah.
This is also better than Injustice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I love this book. And also, like, this is really, like, the peak of Stuart Immonen's art.
Oh, it's so good. Oh, yeah. But the art alone is worth the price of admission.
Yeah, and I think about every issue, there is a big scenic splash page, which we mentioned them as we were
that each reflect it. The different eras of Superman, yeah. Like the different stages of Superman's life.
Mm-hmm.
You get the big mountains and fields from Smallville, the big cityscapes for
in this case New York, but in yeah. regular Superman Metropolis.
Yeah, and they're all just like
he goes to the Arctic, so that's the fortress stuff. Mm-hmm.
They're just beautiful, and like you could make all of them like a desktop background.
I might start making one of these shots my desktop background after this.
The only thing is, I mean, just while we're winding down, just some nitpicks. I think the covers on all the issues are kind of uninspired. Like they kind of use like a.
They're kind of pulpy. I like that.
Yeah, it's like they're not traditional comic book covers. It's kind of like a figure and then like kind of a montage thing, which it's fine.
Overall, I think we all enjoyed the story.
Yep.
Definitely worth a pickup. I'd say yeah. Easily.
Yeah,
For a short book, I think it's pretty inexpensive, and I think it's a great read and something you can definitely go back in the later years and
I
reread.
I think
if we were to read this at different points in our lives, we would take different things from it.
Yeah,
and it would always be a good
it's
thing.
It's definitely a book I'll definitely like want to revisit every few years. I think it's probably essential for your Superman collection.
Yeah,
easily.
This is on my list, my personal list of like here are the five books to start with. Like everyone has their like here's the five Batman books, and like this for me is definitely in the five Superman books.
Anything else we want to say in closing thoughts? Kirk Busiek is now teamed up with John Paul Leone doing Batman Creature of the Night, which is basically his version of
Batman.
This. Two issues are out now.
I will definitely be interested in picking that up when it's out in trade see how similar it is and see what they do with it.
When it's up and finished, do you want to maybe take a look at that one for a review?
Yeah, I could, yeah.
Something we could do.
I would definitely be interested in seeing if they set it in the same world.
That would be interesting.
I don't think they will, but I think it'd be interesting. No.
As far as I know about Creature of the Night, it has been late.
Mm-hmm.
Also, so this book, it's set like, I mean, eventually it's set pretty much when it came out, even though like the character grows up in like the late 80s and stuff like that.
Creature of the Night's mostly set in the past.
Yeah, Creature of the Night, I believe it's set in like the 40s or 50s because there's a major development. And again, it's like a metaphorical thing where Bruce goes to live with, I believe, like his uncle or something.
Mm-hmm.
And it's heavily hinted at that he's a closeted gay man, or maybe he's not closeted, but like.
They talked about it on iFanboy that reviewed the issue.
Yeah, but it's like from the perspective of Bruce, who's a kid at that point and everything like that.
It has to be.
And it's set in the past, so it's very subtle.
When the promo images came out, it was like the kid, whoever the Bruce kid is. Also, I know his name's not Bruce Wayne. It's like Bruce Wainwright or something like that.
Yeah, that sounds familiar.
One of the costumes that he's wearing, one of like the Halloween costumes from like the 1966 show. So I think it's set around then. Because I used to have this book as a kid of like just it was like I think it was just Batmania the book, and it was like every piece of merchandise that had ever been released under Batman. It was kind of it's a really cool book.
Huh.
And that suit was in there, so like I immediately recognized it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, Superman Secret Identity, definitely pick this one up. Have a good one, guys. Get home safe.
You too.
Like and subscribe. Only a man, no phone.
It's not easy to be me.